Welcome to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast, brought to you by TournamentPokerEdge.com, the only podcast dedicated exclusively to tournament poker strategy. And now, here are your hosts, RonFezBuddy and Killingbird.
Hey everybody, welcome to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. I am Killingbird, aka Derek, and I'm here with my co-host, RonFezBuddy, aka Diego. How's it going, man?
I'm good. Hi, everyone. How you doing, Derek?
I'm doing pretty well. Excited to be working on the second of our Tournament Poker Edge podcasts. I thought the first one went really well, and from the feedback we've been hearing, it seems like everybody out there feels the same way.
Yeah, I had a lot of fun doing the first one, and with the topic and the guys we have coming on today, I'm looking forward to this one as well. I listened back to myself, and I thought it was really cool to just finally hear some strategy being talked about, tournament strategy being talked about in depth. So a lot of fun, and look forward to doing this one as well.
Yeah, it seemed like a lot of people liked the format and the content, and you know, of course, having guys like Ween and Big Dog to talk strategy with is going to make anything pretty good. So it was nice to have them.
You mean having guys like Big Dog and Ween berate the host?
Yeah, that was a little hard to take, but that's what we're here for.
Yeah, and just reveal how big of a donk we really are. Really, I am. No, it was fine. It was actually really good for me. Having those guys. I think we said this last week, but having guys like that look at your hands and the way you play and give you feedback. You know, it's never going to be easy because they're the best, right? So they're going to find a lot of things that you do wrong. And guys who are the best like that, they just are – I mean, these guys were really straightforward, right? Like they're upfront, they're honest, and they don't sugarcoat it. And you got to have a thick skin if you're going to ask those guys to come on. And I really – you know, it was a little tough to take because I made some bad mistakes, but it really opened my eyes to some things that I did wrong, and I'm – glad to have seen it because I've been thinking differently the last 2 weeks, and I hope that that's how some of the people who were listening to the podcast took the information as well.
Yeah, you're exactly right, and I know for me personally, like I've been working on various parts of my game, and one of the things that I've been doing, having watched a lot of Casey's videos, was starting to work on my bet sizing a little bit, which is actually a topic we'll get into more here in a bit. But then I was watching. The early cuts of the next Ticket to the Man series, which is Casey and T-Twist reviewing my video. Uh-huh. And I realized that I still have a long way to go in working on my bet sizing. you think you're making progress in the right direction, or maybe even think you're there, and then you realize you still have, you know, a ton to learn. So it's a never-ending process, and we're pretty fortunate to get to have those guys.
Yeah, and it's pretty crazy when the stuff that comes up was like the parts that they crushed me on, I didn't even realize were going to be the tough parts of the hand, right? Because they were just like leaks that were ingrained in my head. Because quite frankly, when I played those hands, I was eight tabling and probably sitting on my laptop, and not really paying attention to street by street action. I actually have cut down the number of tables in the past couple of weeks just to think a little bit more while I'm playing and not be so automatic and think street by street and try to put people on more ranges and stuff. And it's really helped me attack the game a little bit, I think, a little bit better. But it's amazing that you can make some of these mistakes and not even realize where the mistakes are happening. You bring the tough hand because you think the turn is tough, and then the flop is where you made a big mistake.
And speaking of trying to get better and improve your game, how have things been going for you with poker?
I actually shipped the 2750 /20K turbo. It's a turbo at 1140 Eastern on Stars just a week ago, so I'm in a good mood.
Very nice.
And I'm trying to let it last. You know, it's like when you win something, it doesn't last as long as the elation doesn't last as long as the downswing dejection lasts.
Right.
So I'm trying to hold on to it, and I'm already I've had some the last 2-3 sessions haven't gone well, so I'm still trying to hold on to that feeling of winning. But yeah, I took down that tournament. It was pretty fun, good feeling, and I think I really do think that I'm thinking a little bit deeper about the game. I find myself thinking, about flops and, you know, just yeah. thinking about hand ranges even when I'm not playing, and it's pretty cool. So overall going pretty well. I'm happy to report that. How are you doing? What are you
up to? Not too bad. I've actually not been playing as much as I'd like lately. Things have been, you know, busy, obviously, with Tournament Poker Edge and just life in general, so haven't been putting in the volume that I would like lately, but I've put in enough to go on a decent-sized downswing.
Yeah.
I had a nice run there, I guess maybe now 3 weeks or 4 weeks ago, where I final tabled that 10K on AP in back-to-back right. sessions.
Yeah, that was pretty sick.
Yeah, it was fun, you know, finishing first and second. And like you said, like you want that glow to last forever, but of course it never does. And, you know, a couple weeks later, I'm in the middle of a bit of a downswing. But it's really not anything that I'm panicking about yet, especially, you know, having had conversations with other people who've had much worse. So,
yeah.
So, I'm just grinding away. I'm actually going to take a few days off coming up here and try to get rested up and get my mind cleared out a little bit. And then I'm going to get back to the grind. So,
cool.
You'll see some sweat threads from me here in the forum soon.
Cool. Yeah, I actually, after the day, I actually shipped that tournament, and then I went to Vegas for a work thing, not for specifically for poker, for my day job, and then I got to play at night. So I haven't really been playing as much online, but I got to play some live tournaments in Vegas last week, and that was pretty fun, and a change of pace too. It's always fun to, you know, it could be a grind, and it's kind of a weird, different, and I think we should discuss a little bit, a weird, different situation when you're playing these live nightly tournaments in Vegas. But it's fun because it's a different, you know, it's a different venue, right? It's just it changes, you have to think again in slightly different ways. You're playing against different type of players.
Yeah.
So I had fun, even though I ended up not winning anything. I made a final table. The first tournament I played, so I was there for three nights, I think, three or four nights, and I played every night, starting usually at 7. And I made a final table on the – and these aren't big tournaments. These are like 70 or 80 or 90 people, the max, right?
Yeah.
But I made the final table as a chip leader in one of them, and I finished 8th, which kind of sucked. But, like, you get to the final table, and I was chip leader with 16 big blinds, right? So it's like
yeah.
it doesn't really mean anything. And you know, I lost tens to queens to the guy who had second chips, right? So I ship tens and he wakes up a queen. So, you know, that just shows you the variance in those types of things. But those are pretty fun. And they're interesting. I have to say, if you are going to go to Vegas, I could recommend a daily tourney to play. If you're going to go to Vegas and if there's no big series happening, I would definitely recommend the Caesars tournaments, the Caesars nightly tournaments. Now, I didn't play in the daytime, so I don't know any of the daytime structures and what's good there. Although I looked at them, and this seemed to be even still the best one around. 30-minute levels and all the levels you really would expect, you know, like 25-50, 50-100, 100-200, 100-200 ante, 150-300, 2-4, 3-6. I mean, that's pretty good for a live tournament with 30-minute levels, right? I mean, you've played a lot of live tournaments before, right?
Yeah, especially for those nightlies, like you said, sometimes you get some crazy jumps. You know, you go from like 2-4 to 4-8 or something, you know, something crazy like that. Or it'll just skip that 100, 200 with annies and go, you know, straight up from there. It sounds like a pretty good structure.
It was, you know, actually, you reminded me. I played at a tournament, like, you know, a home game tournament, like a charity. So I think that people are raising money for a wrestling team or something. I don't know. I just go play, right? And like, I look at the structure sheet and they go up to 2-5, you know, 2-2, 2-500, 500, sorry. Then they go 5-1, then they go 1,000, 2,000, 2,000, 4,000, 4,000, 8,000, 8,000, 16,000. It's like 15-minute levels. And I'm like, I tell the guy, I'm like, you know, this is ridiculous. Like, you know, I'm not like one of those pushy people. Like, I really, like, don't get in people's faces. But I was just like, I try to tell the guy, this is just an awful structure. If you know anything about poker, it's an awful structure. But they didn't change it. And I ended up winning it anyway, so whatever. Brag.
Yeah.
So if you're going to go to Vegas and you're looking for the nightly tournaments, I played at Venetian and I played at Caesars. I've played at Mirage before. I've played at Mandalay Bay before. I was going to check out Aria, the new casino, but I didn't because the Caesars tournament just dominated it, you know, in terms of structure. So
right.
I looked around, I did a lot of research, and I really think those Caesars tournaments are pretty good and pretty fun. And And I really, you know, I got to play a lot of them, and I enjoyed it. And I tell you, they're different. So you've played a lot of these live tournaments, right? And I think the one in AC is coming up. The WSOP circuit event is coming up in AC in December, right? And you're going to that?
I'll be there for that. And yeah, and I've played a few out in Vegas, but when I lived in LA and used to go to Vegas a lot, I wasn't really crazy into poker yet. So I really got into poker once I moved to the East Coast. So most of my sort of nightly donkament experience is up in Atlantic City. But you know, I think the structures are pretty similar across casinos all over the country. So
yeah, it's just, I think we should do a show on it sometime, like when there's a big live event happening. Maybe we'll do one before AC, or maybe we'll do one before the World Series or something. But it's definitely a different game. I actually struggled with it a bit up front because I wasn't used to six people to a flop and people just calling a lot. And I was, you know, I'm like, well, I have a skill edge. I'm going to raise every pot, and, you know, and
right.
I'm going to c-bet and double barrel. And, you know, it was just very messy. And it, I would go from 10K to 6K, you know, within like the first, you know, level or two, which really was unnecessary. And then I would pick it all back by having a huge edge on these guys when stacks were shorter. So I think next time I go, I'm just going to like really tighten up early stages and just try to extract value. And something I learned from just practice, you know, and the last one I played, I think I definitely played much better in that regards. And I just went out 14th. Oh man, listen to this one. So I'm not doing a bad beat story.
Okay.
we're playing. I'm grinding down. There's 14 people left. I think the full final table pays. And I'm finally opening up chips and, you know, a stack. And they move this guy over to our table, and he's the huge chip leader. And like this guy, while he's stacking up his chips, you know, I shove my jacks into his kings in the big blind. It's like the guy didn't even finish like putting his chips out of his rack, and he just grabbed my 30 big blinds and added them to his stack, and then I was done. So
he's like, thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, he's like, yeah, it's like, you're welcome. Anyway, all right. So anyway, yeah, fun times.
And I'm sure, you know, like you said, we're heading up to Atlantic City in December for the circuit event, which, you know, of course, the World Series of Poker circuit events have really quite good structures. But I think while we're there, we'll have to make sure we get over to like the Borgata or, you know, one of those Showboat or something to play one of those nightlies, especially if we get some members who come out and want to go out and play a tournament at night. We'll go hit one of those things, and we can all exchange bad beat stories afterwards.
Yeah. Well, the SOP tourneys themselves have really good structures. I mean, I was looking at the sheet for the one that just finished in Hammond, and really, really good structures. And I think even they're like, you know, their fast tournament, their $250, $300 one or whatever, has more levels than, you know, most of these nightly tournaments and longer levels. So it should be, you know, a good tournament to play.
Yeah, I think it's going to be fun. And I'm obviously looking forward to hanging out with all the Tournament Poker Edge guys and a bunch of our members. So it'll be a fun time.
Cool. All right. So what are we talking about today, Derek?
Yeah, today we're actually bringing in Hit the Panda and Hagbard Celine to talk a little bit about bet sizing, which we actually alluded to earlier. And I told you is something that I've really been trying to work on. And as I mentioned, you know, obviously still have a lot of work to do. And I think for a lot of people, I think bet sizing is a big leak and something that we all probably need to address.
Right.
I think it's going to be a really good conversation.
Yeah, and it's a good, you know, we're trying to keep a structure, some sort of logical flow through how we go through these topics for strategy. And we're trying to stay, you know, we're still in the early stages, and it's really important when you're deep stacked to understand street by street how to size your bets appropriately for later streets. And like you said, I think there's definitely a lot of leaks there and also a lot of tells for bet sizing. So I'm definitely interested in hearing what these guys have to say about c-betting. And, you know, we've always heard 2/3 of the pot, and I wonder if that's still relevant, you know, and is it necessary, or can you do something different? And how do we bet size if we want, you know, we're trying to get flop is dry and we have an overpair and we want to try to, we're trying to get it in, you know, how do we bet size appropriately? And I just think there's a lot of thought that should be going into it. And, you know, this is what they're going to help us figure out today. So I'm excited about that. Ready to talk to them.
Yep. I'm looking forward to it as well. So we'll take a quick break, and we will be right back with Hit the Panda and Hagbard Celine here on the Tournament Poker Edge podcast.
Are you looking for a poker training site that focuses exclusively on poker tournaments? Tired of wading through cash game videos looking for the occasional tournament video? Well, look no further than TournamentPokerEdge.com. In addition to training videos, Tournament Poker Edge has blogs, forums, a member chat room, poker-related articles, and much more. Pros include Casey, Big Dog Pocket Fives, Jarzabek, Ryan Hit the Panda Franklin, and Jonathan Ween. Tournament Poker Edge has the lowest monthly price, and unlike most poker training sites, there is no initial sign-up fee. So sign up today and find out why Tournament Poker Edge has quickly become the number one choice of tournament players looking to improve their poker skills. TournamentPokerEdge.com.
Hey everybody, welcome back to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. It's time to bring in our special guests, Ryan Hit the Panda Franklin and Charles Hagbard Celine Sizemore, coming in to talk a little bit about strategy today. What's up, guys?
How's it going?
Hey. Hey, Ryan. So weird to have such a long name.
You chose it. What are you talking about?
No, that's his actual full name. That's the name that his parents gave him.
Actually, you know what? Before we start, why don't you just explain what that is? Because I think a lot of people looking in don't know exactly what a Hagbard Celine is.
Hagbard Celine is the main character of probably my favorite book. It's a science fiction. Well, it was originally a series, but it's now released as like one volume called the Illuminatus Trilogy.
Yeah. That's something new every day.
There you go. He is our resident intelligista. When we need someone smart to figure something out, we go to Charlie.
Resident nerd.
Well, I chose a fancier word that wasn't so derogatory, but it's all you, buddy. Thanks for joining, guys. And so today we're going to be talking about early stage play, like we did last week with Casey and John. And this time we're going to shift our focus a little bit from specific types of hands to the concept of bet sizing. I think this is a really important topic for really players on every level, from beginner to intermediate to advanced. And I know as advanced players, you guys do certain things and conduct certain practices that I think really help you guys extract value. But I think a lot of mistakes are made by less experienced players when they either reveal the strength of their hand through their bet sizing or they don't extract value well enough. And so we wanted to just kind of get your guys' opinions on bet sizing and go through a couple of hands as examples of you know, specific spots where the hero was presented with an option to size a bet and what would have been the best thing to do.
Yeah, and one thing that I hear people say a lot when pros are asked, you know, what is the number one like leak you see or what is the number one improvement you think people need to make? You hear bet sizing a lot. So I'm just wondering if Charlie and Ryan, if you guys agree with that, do you feel like that is the number one thing that people out there need to be working on?
I definitely think that bet sizing is probably one of the biggest leaks that players can have, and there are huge bet sizing tells that a lot of players have. So yeah, I guess I would agree. Definitely agree with that.
Sorry, I think it is a pretty big leak for a lot of people, just mainly because a lot of people are over bet sizing in spots where they don't need to be, and they're losing chips that way actually, and they may not realize it. So not only is it something that you have to focus on to prevent, you know, opponent getting a read on you and being able to balance, but you're also you know, using the least amount of chips or the most amount of chips necessary in each spot, like on the flop and turn and river, so you don't have to put in bigger bet sizes. And if they actually have a hand, if you're bluffing, then you lose less that way as well.
Charlie, can you give us an example of a bet size tell?
Just like the standard one of betting big with big hands and small with bluffs is something that I think you see, or I'll see a lot of players do, and it's just easy to play against a player that you know is doing that. Obviously, you just fold more when they're betting big and call more when they're betting small.
What do you make of when someone makes it 4x out of nowhere? What does that usually mean?
It's usually really strong.
Yeah, it's usually a hand I don't imagine that they're planning on folding.
Yeah, I think that's a better way to put it, because it might not necessarily be super strong, but it's a hand he feels is super strong.
Exactly. Like it might be like eights, which...
Right.
In certain situations, like, really isn't that strong, but when you see somebody 4x, you can sort of assume that they believe their hand is very strong and they don't want to fold it. Unless, I mean, then there's also, I mean, you don't want to overgeneralize. You will find people, they're few and far between, but who 4x is a standard.
Yeah, I mean, that's obviously different, but I think for the most part,
yeah, definitely for the most
4x's,
part.
Especially out of the blue, like, if they had been 3xing and then suddenly they 4x, then they mean business.
And so pre-flop, we're in early stages. You know, we're talking about early stages, but pre-flop, do you guys generally, when do you guys go from 3x to like 2.5x? Is there like a certain point in the tournament or blind size where you start to make it smaller, or do you always start, do you start with 3x, or do you go like 4x at 10-20? What's your general strategy there?
Usually I 3x until, I usually do more based on stack size and pre-ante. When my stack size gets to like, I guess around 60 big blinds-ish, I'll change from 3x to 2.5x, and that even matters. Like if it's at 25-50, I'll still do that. Like if my stack size is around 3K at 2550, I'll start making it 125, and then if I drop down more to like 2000 to 2500, I'll make it a min raise. That's mainly just the shorter the stack size, the higher the stack to pot ratio, meaning that you'll have more maneuverability post flop because the pot's not going to be so high where you're just going to have to like, you know, you bet and they call and then the turn's like half your stack. It's just to make the pot as small as possible before the flop comes so that you can, you know, do stuff like double barrel and fold or be able to put in a raise in and not be committed or whatever. But for the most part, I do like around 50 big blinds to 60, I'll make a 2.5x pre-ante. And then I guess 40 big blinds and below, I change it to a min raise. But not a lot of people do that with the min raise part. I guess it's just preference, but I like to do it.
Yeah, that's actually really interesting because a lot of times what you hear people say is they base it strictly on the blind size when, you know, you'll hear people say, well, I start to 2.5 exit when antes kick in or whatever. And it's interesting that you base it more on your stack size than on the size of the blinds.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't really matter, I guess, what the blinds are. I think it's more about what your stack size is and what the other stack sizes are at the table.
Yeah, that's something I used to have like a rule where when I got to 80, 160, I would start 2.5x in it. But probably through watching people like Ryan play that I started realizing that what's far more important is just your actual stack size in terms of big blinds and what you want to start developing as like a general plan for the hand. Like Ryan said, when your stack's smaller, it's more beneficial for you to keep the pot smaller pre-flop so that you can do the same things that you can do with a deeper stack when you're 3xing it.
So if we're at like 50 and 100 and we have like 3K and it gets folded to us like in only position we want to open. So is like 225 or 250 there good, or would you just go to 2, or would you stay higher at that point?
Yeah, I would go smaller usually.
I mean, I would probably agree with Ryan that it doesn't matter too much. You know, like I'd imagine he would min raise with 30 big blinds there. He's also like a very good post-flop player. I don't think there's anything wrong with going to like 225 or 250, especially if you're not that confident post flop, because when you're min raising, you are going to get flatted more often. That extra 50 is going to make an appreciable difference in the amount you get flatted and have to play post flop.
Yeah. I'm not saying it's like the best strategy to do what I do with like the min raises and whatnot. I know a lot of people who like, even, you know, most of the top players don't do the same thing, but it's more of a preference thing. But I do think that you should, definitely stop 3xing when you're like around 50 to 60 big blinds.
Cool. And then what about once we get to the flop? If we, you know, when we, what do you guys usually see betting? Is it between 60 and 70%? Is there a general guideline that you guys can recommend? Or, I mean, I know everything is just dependent, but.
Yeah, that's another one that's really a lot like just based on the stack sizes. I mean,
right.
A lot of the time I'll go half pot C bets up to like, I guess 50, 60 big blinds again, and then I might make it like 58% or something like that, just a little bit over. And then if you get like, you know, if you have people that are flatting you with 20 to 30 big blind stacks, I'll make my C bets like 1/3 pot.
Even pre-ante that early?
Yeah. I mean, if they're going to flat with those stack sizes, I mean, they, with their stack, they just have to, you know, their stack to pot ratio is much smaller than mine, so they're really going to have to make a lot of their decisions for the whole hand based on the flop. So, you know, a lot of the time they're just going to pitch it if they don't have anything, especially when the people are flatting that set. Flatting that sizes are a lot worse, and they're going to be folding to a lot more C bets. So when they actually do want to call and they're calling no matter what, you know, you might as well get away with it for cheaper.
Exactly. That's a really good tip.
And board texture is important too. Like you can adjust your C bet size a bit based on board texture. Like textures where it's very unlikely for someone to have hit and they're just folding a lot.
Yeah, like even deep, like if the flop's like 2-2-7 and they call my under the gun open, like I'll just bet half pot like I always usually, or a little bit less depending on stack sizes.
And what about, I always hear you guys in your videos talk about, you know, sort of having a plan and getting, you know, sort of sizing your bets to get all your chips in when you know that you have your strong hand or you're way ahead. So, and it's hard to kind of abstract without a hand in front of us, and we're going to have some hands that I think we talk about this, but just generally, you know, is there a way that you can size your bets when you know that you're trying to get it all in on the flop, on the turn, and then to get, like, what are we trying to get to? Are we trying to get to a pot size bet on the river? Are we trying to get to where, you know, our stack is significantly less than the pot so that, you know, like half the pot, or is there generally something you're working towards when you're trying to get the stacks in?
There's just so many variables to take into account. Like, it's going to depend a lot on your opponent and their tendencies, what you think their range is, what your exact hand is, stack sizes. I mean, it's just going to depend on a lot.
Anything else, Derek, before we jump into the hands?
Nope, I think that's it. Let's jump right into the hands. Okay, so hand number one is actually taken from our forums over at tournamentpokeredge.com. It's from a Full Tilt Poker 10.5K guarantee. It's a rebuy. The hero is in the small blind with 7-5 offsuit. So we start the hand with 13.6K, and the blinds are only 50 to 100, so obviously we're very deep. We get a couple of limbers, and it gets to us in the small blind, and we complete the extra 50. So first of all, guys, do you even think we should be completing here in the small blind with 5-7 off?
I wouldn't. I would probably just fold. 7-5 off is just pretty crap hand, gapped, unsuited. We're not really going to flop many strong hands.
Yeah, I mean, you're mainly looking to hit a straight, and that's like the only thing really. And you're 14K deep, so then, you know, percent of times you hit a straight versus percent of times you get in a hand like this and lose like 1/4 your stack by the river, it's not going to work out in your favor.
Yeah, you know what I think happens here is you think, well, if I flop a straight or I hit 5-7, I could get paid by aces or whatever. But what I think you guys are saying, and I think a lot of people fail to recognize, is that you get yourself with these middling hands that you have to call a couple of bets where you're just bleeding, you know, 1,000 chips or 2,000 chips along the way because you're not quite sure, and then you can't call a river bet or something along those lines. And that costs you a lot more in the long run than you make from hitting that magical flop. I think people discount the chips they lose even without getting to showdown.
I would agree with that, and I also think people just get sloppy when they have all these chips and forget to – or not forget to realize, maybe they just don't realize in the first place that the deeper you are, the more important it is to be in position and the bigger a disadvantage it is to be out of position. When you're like 140 big blinds deep, you're just going to make far bigger mistakes out of position than you will.
Yeah, and you can't maximize your value as much when you're out of position.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
So basically, there's nothing working for this guy here. He just had nothing going for him.
Well, the good news, I guess, is that we go to the flop here four ways.
And we
the
have
flop
a straight
comes,
draw.
Yeah, the flop comes 4-5-6 with two diamonds. So in terms of hands we were hoping to see, I guess this certainly fits into the category of a decent flop for us.
Yeah.
So when we flop this
is that this flop also smashes the range of both those limpers.
What you mean, like they're gonna have what, a couple over pairs or even a couple sets in that range or even draws?
Yeah. Sets,
I mean, yeah, a lot of their limp preflops, especially when they limp in early position, a lot of people love to do that with like little connectors and pairs.
So there, right, you're gonna see people with sets, straights, nut flush draw, and two overs, nut flush draw and a straight draw.
Yeah, so I'd be looking to check call and not really trying to make this pot bigger, even though it does seem to be decent for our hand.
Yeah, because once you bet and you're faced with raises, now you have a bloated pot, right? And so every decision is going to be very expensive, whereas if we keep it small, we have decisions to make, but they're not as impactful to our stack. And later on, if we have to make a decision on the river, it's not going to be for the entire stack.
Yeah, right. I mean, when we bet and then three bet, we're just getting to a point where we're going to get the chips in at an equity disadvantage. Like, he's going to have the equity, and we're going to be at a disadvantage in the hand. Whereas you can check and call and probably profitably here with second pair in the open-ended straight draw. But I don't think you can bet three bet, get the money in profitably here.
So you're really just to start with, you're just probably check calling this flop.
Definitely.
Yep.
But once you bet and get raised, then you're gonna flat that raise, I assume.
Oh yeah, I mean, yeah, it's definitely. 250 more. It's like a min raise.
Yeah,
you've got direct odds for a straight draw as well. So I mean, there's no point to fold.
So the bet sizing here is to not bet. We want to keep it small. We want to keep this pot small. Okay, that makes sense.
So in the actual hand as played, our hero leads out from the small blind with, you know, middle pair and an open ender. He leads out for 255. The big blind calls, and then the under the gun, the original under the gun limper raises to 510. And then when it comes back to us, the hero makes it 1320. So as we've discussed, this is just sort of bloating the pot and spewing, and really we should just be check calling this flop.
Yeah.
Okay. So we go to the turn with a 3650 in the pot, and the turn is the 8 of diamonds. So now we've hit our straight, but obviously the turn also brought a flush draw. So with 3650 in the pot, and we obviously still have a lot of chips behind, are we now betting this?
I would check fold, depending on sizing. I mean, if he bets again, then you're chopping at best most of the time. You know, most sets are two pair or whatever going to check back that flop or that turn most, like 99% of the time. So if he bets, he has a flush or a straight, and neither of those you're really beating. So I'd probably fold, unless he made it like 1/10 pot or whatever.
Yeah, I think that this is a spot where the difference between me and Ryan starts to materialize, because I don't know if in game I would actually fold here, but I know this is the type of fold that Ryan's really good at making, and when I hear him describe it, it seems obvious that check fold here is best.
Yeah, it just seems like after he raises you on the flop and then you call and then he bets when the diamond gets there and the straight gets there, like he's not, and especially when he bets big, it's just not anything he really is not beating you, I don't think.
Yeah, I was going to ask, you know, speaking of bet sizing, what do you make of Villain basically betting pot on the turn here?
I mean, to me it looks like he has a flush draw and he thinks you have a straight draw, which we do.
On the turn? On the turn where we where the...
Or not a draw, but, you know, on the flop.
Right, okay. Not,
on the flop you had a draw, but now he's like, okay, completed, and I just hit my ace 3 of diamonds or whatever, and now I can stack him by the river because you guys are so deep. The bigger he's betting on the turn means he wants to get as much as he can on the river, I assume, and that means that the bigger he's betting on the turn is more of a nut hand, so he probably has the flush.
Yeah, actually, I think this is interesting from the villain's perspective. If we think that the villain, you know, has hit a flush here, what is this a good this a good number? This he bets 3,300 into 3,650.
I mean, no.
What's a good number if we assume we're going to try to get in?
I guess it's all right, but it just seems a little bit big.
Yeah, right.
I mean, considering the flop action, I guess you could get away with a really transparent bet size like this, especially in this tournament, if the player you're playing against is weak and you don't think he's really hand reading well, and you think he has a straight here a ton of the time and can't fold it, then, you know, by all means go for max value, but it's definitely exploitable.
Yeah, another thing here with the whole hand in general, something you can do more often when you're facing a decision like that on the turn is to go back and look on the flop and see what happened. And you know, you gotta really ask yourself what he's really raising a min raise on the flop, like 255 to 510, especially if someone else left to act, and it's a lot more likely that it's like some kind of a draw than, and especially after he calls the 3-bet on the flop.
Yeah.
So it's more likely, in my opinion, some kind of like a draw that's just like, all right, I don't want you to have the lead in the hand, so I'm gonna min raise.
Okay, so he bets 3,300 into 3,650. So if he assumes that the hero calls, they're gonna have about approximately 11K pot by the river. And I think that's going to be a little more than what the hero has left in his hand.
Yeah, we have a little bit less than pot left.
Right. So, okay. So what would you bet here then if you were this vet man and he
on the river?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I would plan on shoving.
Just shove it, right? Okay. Yeah, because I think that's the question now. So let's assume, I know we're kind of taking the hand backwards and we're removing the hero from the center of this hand, but if the villain has the strong hand here and now we have a pot-sized bet left, and imagine the hero checks to us, do we believe we'll get called enough? Well, I guess
it doesn't matter at that point whether you think that you're going to believe that you're going to get called or not. It's just more of one, I mean, yeah, sometimes you're definitely going to call, but sometimes you're going to fold as well. But it's more of the fact of, is this the way this guy played the hand versus me, and now he's checking the river, does he really ever have me beat? Right. And if he doesn't, then you just got to assume that you have the best hand and hope he calls you down.
Okay, and we don't want to try to do like a small bet to try to get him to call with a weaker hand. Like if we bet like 3K or 4K, you know, a third of the pot.
Well, I think at the lower limits on a board like this, where like if you have the flush and it's so obvious that someone probably has like a straight or something that you beat, then I just try and go maximum value and hope they station.
Yeah, I think a lot of people don't do that. I think there's a mistake there. And you definitely see it at the higher levels. But I think at the lower levels, you don't see people realizing that the person has come along with you this far.
And yeah, I think a lot of people definitely don't maximize their value.
Yeah. You just got to think, why is this person coming this far with me? And even though he's checking to me, he has a hand that he believes has showdown value. And when I bet pot here, you know, he might call it just as much as he calls 3,400 because he thinks his hand is strong enough to see the showdown.
And okay, well, just as a comment, this river blocking bet is just, I mean, I don't understand what it accomplishes other than getting called, other than losing money.
Right.
It definitely accomplishes that. Because when the board pairs, the one part of his range that you were beating, you now lose to.
Right.
If he happened to have a set that he was playing a little too fast.
See, like the river actually is like a fun spot. Like if you were facing someone where you can actually like
check shove, or
yeah, well maybe not check shove, but like just suddenly like lead your whole stack, like just shove pot where there is. But it really doesn't make sense at the same time. So like it'd have to be like I doubt you're ever gonna need a fold. But if someone really thought that maybe, just because I doubt you're check calling the turn with the two pairs head when it's so big, so you really can't represent. But if it was like small on the turn where maybe you would just check call that scary turn with like a set or two pair and try and boat up because you didn't believe them or just because you wanted to boat up, and then suddenly you boat and just shove because you think they might check behind, but I doubt it.
Yeah.
Just me being crazy.
No, it is a cool spot, and it's a good card for us, but yeah, I think you're right. I don't think he's ever folding.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's move on to hand number two. You want to run this one down for us, Diego?
Yeah, okay, so let's see what happens here. This is also from the forum. It was a $1 tournament. Blinds are at 10-20, and our hero is in the big blind with 1970, and so he's got about 198 big blinds. He has queens in the big blind, and there are there's three limpers, including the small blinds, and it gets to him in the big blind, and he makes it 130. So first off, I guess a question for you guys is, with multiple limps, what do you guys usually raise? Is it the standard 3x plus one for each limp, or do you guys?
Out of position, I might make a little bit more.
Okay.
Yeah, that's my standard rule, but when it's out of position, I'll add another big blind or two.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'd probably make like 160 here pre.
Yeah, because then one guy calls, then you're going to have a cascading series of callers, right?
Yeah.
And you're going to play out of position, not just one guy, but four guys.
But, yeah.
So, like, and if you can make it close to the pot where, like, if you get a good flop, you're basically just going all in.
Exactly. Like we were saying before, if you are forced to play out of position, you're much better off playing as shallow as possible. So making this, knowing that we're going to be getting at least one or all of them to call, you want to make it a little bit bigger so that post-flop you can just sort of bet call good flops and not have to really worry about it.
Why are we better off being shallow out of position? That's an interesting point.
Just because there's less room for you to make a big mistake. Their range is going to be wide enough that you can just bet call it off as opposed to like three bets going in on a flop or something like that.
And so if the flop is, you know, awful for us, if there's a king or an ace on it, does that mean that because we're shallow, we're more likely to just check fold? Or we get, you know, I mean, I know
it would depend.
In this hand.
It would
depend
on how many people. If it were heads up, I guess I wouldn't really be looking to fold necessarily. But if we got like three callers and we went four way to an ace high flop, I might just check fold. Yeah.
Okay. Well, in this case, the hero makes it 130. So he had the right idea. He didn't. You know, he I think he went. He did go bigger than just 3x plus one. He added another 10 chips in there, but not as big as I think you guys were recommending.
It looks like – is that just pot? It looks like it might just be pot.
Maybe it is. Maybe it is. Okay, so that's what he does. And then he does get unfortunately called by three, the same three guys. It looks like one guy folded. So now he's going four-handed to the flop. And, you know, he's the flop is 540 chips in the pot, and he's, you know, at this point got
2,000.
No, he's got
actually
about
1,800.
Yeah, 1840, I think. So, okay, so he's got 1840, and he's first to act, and it's 9-5 jack. So, I mean, obviously, I'm assuming we really like this flop. What's a good c-bet size here with the flop being 540? The pot's 540, right?
Anything like 300 to 350.
Okay. Why not smaller? Why not bigger?
Bigger is just going to be really obvious, and people probably fold jacks. Even at the lower level, just because they're like, okay, he has an overpair. But smaller, I think, just gets a lot of, like, four ways. You don't want people to really be calling, like, 6-7, and, like, there's random draws and nines that can hit two pair. I mean, I guess you do want them, but I think if you make it around, like, a little over half pot, it inspires people to shove more often than call, and you want people to just try and get their whole chips in on this flop with any kind of draw or whatnot.
Right.
But I think betting smaller can be okay. Like, I don't think it's bad. I think it's much better to bet smaller than to bet bigger.
Cool. Yeah, he goes to 360. So I think that's right in the range you kind of were talking about, right?
Yeah. I mean, I think with, like, a lot of people who don't know what they're doing, it's better to just put more chips in with, you know, the best hand and just hope that they either shove or call or whatever.
So when in doubt, err on the side of slightly bigger.
Yeah, just because I think if they're going to call anything, you know – the difference between 200 or 360, they're just going to call it anyway, so might as well charge them.
Yes, he goes exactly two-thirds, so I think I don't think anyone really has anything to complain about what he bets here. And he does get called by one player. So now we're two-handed. We're going to the turn. There's 1260 in the pot, and turn comes seven of hearts. And he's got 1480 left. So what are you guys doing here? Are you trying to bet small to induce something, get some calls, or are we going to just try to stick it in now and hopefully get a call?
Well, with there being 1260 in the pot and us having just over that, I think I would probably just shove and you know, hope he calls me with the jack. I don't think I feel like betting smaller, considering how if we bet smaller than a shove, we would have to bet like 500 or something like that, something that would look like we're maybe capable of folding. But I think considering that there's just about a pot-sized bet left, it's hard to do that.
Do you ever check here?
No.
No, right?
I just think you're just going to lose value from like Jack X and 9X if he has that.
Right, because, I mean, he called our 360 bet, so – and it's not really that drawy of a flop. I mean, there's the straight draw with the 9 and the Jack out there, but it's not super drawy. So we have to assume he has a piece of this, right?
I would assume that, yeah.
Yeah.
That a large portion of his range is a Jack or a 9.
Right.
And you don't want to give him free equity either.
Yeah. And so the villain, the hero does actually jam here. And we don't know what happened in the message board. On the forum, he didn't post results, so we don't know if we got called or not. But he did jam. He did?
I think it was a good play, and he got called by Jack 10, and he held.
I mean, let's think about that. This guy calls us from – he limped under the gun, and then he calls our raise pre-flop. So, I mean, Jack 10 does sound like right, you know, right in his range, or 9-10 or something, right? I mean, it sounds like – you know, or Jack Queen, right? So it's probably a big part of his range, a weak Jack, and he's probably not folding to that, so.
All right. So, yeah, we'll move on to hand number three here. This hand is also from our forums. This is a PokerStars $2 tournament. And we are at 100-200 with a 25 ante. We start the hand with 31K, so that's about 155 big blinds, so obviously we're really deep, and most of the people at our table are very deep. We're on the button with the 7-8 of diamonds. It folds around to us. I think we can all agree that we're going to raise our 7-8 of diamonds here on the button.
Yeah, definitely.
Cool. All right, so...
And given,
what do you think?
Given how deep we are, I think his raise preflop sizing is fine.
So we're at 1-2, and he bets 565, right? And we have 100. We're deep. We're like we have 100. Well, it's folded to us, and then let's look what's in the blinds.
The small blind has 50 big blinds, and the big blind has 66.
Yeah. So you guys both agree this raise is about the right size. I think I usually make it 555 here as my standard raise. So it's certainly right where I would put it. But you guys both agree.
Looks fun.
Yeah. I like it.
Okay, so we get called by the the small blind and the big blind. So now there's 19, 20 in the pot going to the flop. Flop could not be much better for us. It's 8 of clubs, 10 of diamonds, 9 of diamonds. So we pretty much flop the world. So with 19, 20 in the pot here, we obviously have position on the button. The first player to act bets 200 into this almost 2K pot, and the guy behind him calls. So it comes to us with somebody basically betting 10% of the pot and getting a call. What do we do here? Because you actually see this quite a bit. It's kind of like, well, do I just make like a 3 or 4X raise over this, or do I bet pot and you know, really try to get this thing up?
Before you guys even answer what you do here, what are you thinking when this happens? Because this is like – I have no idea what these guys are doing when they do that.
I treat a min bet like a check pretty much.
That's a good strategy. Okay.
I would just – and like when after the bet and the call, I would just put in, I mean, obviously the pot is now 400 chips bigger, but I would just put in like a normal, whatever my normal C bet would be here. I would just make that raise. I don't like he basically 3Xs over the 200. I don't really like that just because I don't know that we necessarily have the best hand right now. Certainly we have tons of equity, but I would be looking to make it a little bit bigger and just put pressure on these guys to fold eventually at some point in this hand or get money in for when we eventually hit.
I really like the way you put that, where you treat a min bet as a check, because it kind of puts your next move a little bit more in perspective, because I think a lot of times when I see this, I just go, well, it kind of looks ridiculous for me to raise to, you know, 1500 here when he made it 200. But if that's going to be your normal C bet or whatever your normal C bet's going to be, I think it makes a lot more sense in that context. So cool. All right. So as you said, he basically puts in the 3X raise to 665. Both guys call and we go to a turn, which is the four of spades. And there's now almost 4K in the pot, 3915. Both players check to us.
Check it back.
Yeah, you like checking back here?
Yeah.
And why is that? Because we don't have a main hand and it's pot control and all.
Yeah, I mean, the one dude min bets and the other guy calls before it gets to us. So I assume the one guy at min bet probably has some kind of something, like maybe a jack, maybe a seven, maybe a random 10 or a random 8, 9, whatever. But the point is really like on this turn, you know, we didn't hit anything and we've got two people in the pot and the pot's 4K. So really betting is, you know, you're not really sure if they're going to fold any kind of pair. So when you bet, you're really only getting called by better. And now that the turn came, you have less outs. So by this point, I think it's a little bit better to check and just kind of hope to hit, especially when, you know, like you raise the flop and then you check back. It kind of looks like you have nothing. So you might get a lot of value on the river when you do hit,
yeah,
especially against two people. So,
and also like on this turn where we have tons of equity in this pot, and the only way we don't realize that equity is by betting, then it seems kind of stupid to bet.
So good news is our hero checks behind. So it does what at least we think is the right thing. The river brings the jack of clubs. Obviously, the pot is still just under 4K. So now, you know, we've obviously sort of gotten there, but the board is pretty scary now with 8, 9, 10 jack on the board. And villain bets 3,800.
Snap fold.
Yeah, I think this is a pretty easy fold.
Yeah, the first guy does fold, and then it comes to us, and obviously we're looking at a pot-sized bet, so this is just an easy fold here.
I mean, for why it's an easy fold, yeah. I mean, you've got it. This guy's betting pot into two people when both of our ranges could include a queen as well as an eight as well as whatever. So he's really betting into two ranges that aren't suggestively weak on this river, so the fact that he does that makes it so much more likely that he has a queen here, or like even king, queen king.
Yeah, when I see this bet, it's like in this situation as the hand played out, it's like he never doesn't have the queen.
Yeah,
it's like every time.
I mean, if he has a seven, he's not betting it like this. He's probably checking or betting like a blocker kind of bet.
Yep.
All right, we have one more hand for you guys to go over with us. Diego, you want to run this one down for us?
Yeah, so the next hand is from the forums again. It's a $10 tournament on PokerStars. It is 75-150 blinds, and our hero is under the gun with 7.1K, so he has about 47 big blinds, and he has aces. And that's actually quite a few stacks out here. I believe he says this is the first level back on a rebuy. So we're pretty deep stacked here. And at 75/150 this deep, our hero here bets 400. Are we at that range now with the 47 big blinds where we want to go a little less than 3x? Is 400 a reasonable number here at this point?
Yeah, I mean, I'd be min raising, but 400 is definitely reasonable. I don't like 3x with that stack.
Right. So, but Ryan, when you min raise, I mean, when you make it 300, aren't we going to be playing a ton of like 3 or 4 players maybe out of position? Aren't we a little worried about that with such an early position min raise?
Meh.
Could you expand on that meh? I
mean, you will sometimes, but I mean, I don't think it really changes. I don't think the number of flatters you get really changes all that much whether you make a 300 or 400. Mm-hmm. I think you'll still get flatted not just as much maybe, but you know, a good amount as much. And if you're doing it with your whole range, it's not a big deal.
Okay. And do you think part of it too is just the ability to sort of get away from hands like this if things get crazy? You know, like some people I think are afraid, well, if I just min-raise and I get 4 callers and then action gets kind of crazy, like I don't want to ever fold my aces, but...
Well, I mean, you can definitely fold your aces. I mean, you've just got to examine every street if you have the best hand or not. I don't know, I guess I'm just so used to it and comfortable with what's going on. I just, you know, if I feel like my hand's beat, I can get rid of it pretty easily, but I'm just going to play it for value most of the time, and if people are going to go crazy on certain flops, I'm just going to get out of it.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, if I bet like a 7, 8, 9 flop, like I just bet it and then someone raises, I'm just going to fold.
Right.
I mean, it's not that hard.
Right.
And even a flop like King-9-3, like most of the time you're just going to get value. But if suddenly someone does something different on this, you know, board texture than like the 90% of other times you're on this board texture and you just bet and get called by a king, then you can be, you know, comfortable folding it. Like if someone just starts going crazy and trying to make the pot really big, then it usually means you're beat.
Okay. Well, that's, let's talk about that then, because we do get one call here, from the MP2 who has 8K. And remember, we have 7K, so at 75/150, he has 53 big blinds. And there's 1,025 in the pot, and the flop comes King of Diamonds, 9 of Hearts, and 3 of Clubs. So it's King-9-3 Rainbow. And we are first to act, and what's your c-bet size here?
Half pot.
Yeah, so I think a c-bet's pretty much
even right. Like less than half pot.
Really? I just have to say, I wouldn't.
It was four-handed on the flop. Four-handed on the flop, right?
No, it was two-handed. No. Two-handed.
Okay, two-handed on the flop. Yeah, I just bet half pot. Sorry. Half pot. Okay. If it was like three or four-handed, I'd probably bet less.
That's 600 here, into the 1,000, and he gets a call. So, and I don't think there's anything too interesting about that. You know, it's a c-bet. We're trying to get, I think he's trying to get value here from the kings. Just as Ryan, you just said, we're going to, you know, on this kind of board, we're going to bet and try to get value from a king. I think that's what we're trying to do here.
Yeah.
And we do get the call on the flop. And then the turn is the 4 of hearts. So, not, you know, I don't think that really changes much here. And now the pot is 2,200. And if we take away 1,000 from our stack, we're playing with 6,000 behind. So I think this is a really interesting spot to figure out how do we build this pot to where we, you know, do we want to try to get stacks in on the river? And if we do, you know, what's a good bet size here?
Bet whatever leaves yourself, your stack size is the exact stack size of the pot on the river.
So if he bets.
I mean, that's what I do.
Right. Okay. So let's talk about that. So we have 6K left and there's 2K in the pot. So if we bet 2K into the 2K, pot that's there, we're gonna have 4K, and the pot's gonna be 6K.
Yeah, so right. You don't need to bet that much.
Okay, so then let's scale it. So we bet 15K. That means there's gonna be 1,500. That means there's gonna be 5,000 in the pot on the river, and that's gonna leave us with
4,500.
45. We bet it with 1,500.
I would do like 1,350.
Yeah, I was thinking 1,300.
Okay, so we go 1,300. Now we have And, you know, I know we're kind of just doing this math kind of tedious, but I think it actually helps to talk through this. So if we bet 1,300, that's 4,800 in the pot, and we have 47 left.
Yeah, I think that's better. Also, it gives him betting a little bit smaller on the turn is going to – he'll probably call it more. Like if we just suddenly pot it here, he might level himself into a big fold. Then on the river when we shove, there'll be so much money in the pot, so he'll probably be more likely to call.
So I think what we just went through is what I think the point of this hand is, and what I think we want to talk about and get the listeners to start doing. So we're at the turn. So we you know, Ryan, you said bet whatever makes a pot size bet. And is that generally the rule that we should be working with?
Well, generally, if it's not with these stack sizes, yeah. But I'm not going to make like a pot size bet on the turn just so I can shove the river for pot. Like, I still want to be able to keep my turn bets, you know, reasonably sized so that I can make the same bets with air and be able to have double barrels and triple barrels in my range and not have to, like, put in a ton of chips to double barrel someone. So, like, in a spot like this where, like, 40 big blinds, I'm always doing it. But, like, if we're, like, 80 big blinds, I'll just make, like, two-thirds pot on the turn or something if I'm trying to get value.
Yeah, this just so happens to be a spot where you're just betting to get an all-in by the river.
Right. Yeah. And I think that's why I picked this hand from the forum. Because
considering our position pre-flop and then the flop action, like, he's just probably rarely folding. So we can just pretty comfortably just, you know, bet whatever we need to on the turn to shove the river.
Yep.
Yeah. And on that same note, when you get to move up in stakes and playing against the same people and you get a flop like this, that's when you start, you know, king 9-3 flop. People aren't just going to be calling that with a king, so you can start, you know, barreling turns against people who can actually fold and instead of people who never fold. And that's, you know, that's where you get more types of bluffs in your range. And then when you actually make that second barrel on the turn there to 1,300, like, a lot of the time the opponent's going to know that the river shove's coming a good amount of the time. So they're actually going to have to make their decision on the turn there a lot of the time instead of on the river because they know that the shove's coming, and it creates a lot more pressure that way.
Right. Here, I guess we're not assuming he's thinking in that level. We're just assuming he has a king, so we're going to just
– Right, right.
Cool.
Yeah, and you mentioned, you know, obviously we talked about betting 1,350 on the turn or somewhere thereabouts because it sets up that nice river shove, but doesn't it also give the villain a little more room to think maybe he can push us off a hand by jamming?
Sure.
If we bet full pot here, then it's kind of like, well, clearly this guy's never –
I don't think on this texture you're gonna get a lot of played backness, but like if the flop was like two hearts and you might think that he has like a flush draw, then sure, like he could just jam it on the turn.
Good stuff.
Good.
Well, excellent. I want to thank Charles and Ryan for joining us today for the strategy segment of our podcast, and we're gonna take a quick break and we'll be back in just a few minutes.
Thanks, guys. Have a good one.
Thanks for having us.
Yep, it was great being here. See ya.
Hey, this is Killingbird from TournamentPokerEdge.com, here to tell you about our exclusive rakeback program. Tournament Poker Edge offers up to 40% rakeback on sites such as Full Tilt Poker, Absolute Poker, Ultimate Bet, and Cake Poker. If you're playing online and not getting rakeback, you are just giving money away. So visit rakeback.TournamentPokerEdge.com and sign up for the Tournament Poker Edge rakeback program and start getting paid to play today. Welcome back to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. Want to say thank you to Hit the Panda and Hagbard Celine for stopping in. I thought that was a great conversation that we had with those guys today.
I definitely learned some stuff in that one that I has counter to some of the things that I do. That was really interesting.
Yeah, I think for me, like listening to Panda when he was talking about using your stack size to determine your preflop raise size as opposed to the blind levels. Yeah, I think I mentioned it during the segment, but I've always just thought, oh, once antes kick in, I can lower my preflop raise size. Yeah. But it sounds like maybe I need to rethink that a little bit, or at least experiment with it to see. You know, he said himself, you know, it's not what everybody does, but it's something he feels really comfortable doing. So I think I might play around with that a little bit, maybe at the lower stakes to begin with, and then maybe start working that into my game a little bit.
Yeah, well, you know, especially for him, he's so good post flop that he, you know, it's really to his advantage to control the pot sizes moving into that. But I mean, I kind of did that. Like when we get to like 5100 or 75 150, I would be changing my open size already. But he does it even earlier, and like you said, it's the blind not the blind levels, the stack, you know, his stack was really what he was looking at. And he's right. I just never really thought of it that way. I just kind of automatically went when the blinds changed. Because usually it's correlated to, well, you know, the average stack at this blind level, you know, is one of the, you know, makes it correct in many cases. But it's really about your stack or the effective stacks behind you. So that makes a lot of sense. Actually, what really surprised me out of that, and you know, I'll admit this. I always use, you know, I usually bet 2/3. I mean, we're talking about early stages here, so later stages when stacks are shallower, I usually don't see bet, you know, 2/3 of a pot. I usually go a little bit over half. But it really surprised me to hear them recommend half or even under half size C bet percentages based on some of the stacks of the people in the hands. That didn't even enter my mind. That was a discovery for me. It was really interesting.
Yeah, I thought that was pretty fascinating too. And it's one of those things that I think is going to take some practice, not only just to learn how to do everything properly, but also to get comfortable with it. Because like you said, you know, somebody like Ryan is so good post flop that I think it's probably a little easier for him than it will be for me. So I think I need to get to the point where I feel super comfortable post flop and I'm able to kind of play pots and
yeah.
And also, like, he talked about lay down big hands, you know.
Yeah, well, you know what? So. That 8-7 suited hand was pretty interesting where we, you know, we flopped the open-ended – not the open-ended. We flopped the straight flush draw with the 8, and by the time we got to the river, we had the under straight, the low end of the straight, and he recommend, you know, he was, like, instantly fold when the guy bet a pot-sized bet. And, man, like, that's what I'm talking about with thinking about hands. Like, he walked us through – the logic of that hand, and it's a clear fold. When he explained it, it's an absolute clear fold. Yeah. And, you know, just playing 10 tables and not really thinking, you make a lot of mistakes. So that was really interesting to walk through that. And I definitely think I'm going to play less tables and just kind of try to think more street by street than I have.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a really good idea, you know, to sort of scale back the number of tables you're playing. Anytime you realize that maybe you're making some mistakes or you're, like I said, you want to try out some new concepts or something, I think it's always good to scale back the number of tables you're playing so you can pay a little bit more attention, maybe take some notes and sort of, you know, slow everything down a little bit. So
yeah.
I think it's a good idea, and I think I might borrow that idea from you.
Cool. And I also thought the hand with the aces, the last hand we talked about, was pretty interesting. You know, it was a pretty straightforward hand, as both Ryan and Charlie said. You know, in a lower stakes tournament with a board like King 9-3 with aces, you're just going to be trying to get the chips in because you're going to get called by King so much. But once we decided that and the turn was harmless, you know, the question of how did we size our turn bet to extract the most value and set ourselves up for, you know, a pot size river shove, I think it depends on your skill, like your level of sophistication and how much you've played and you know, your experience level. And I think it's pretty straightforward to a lot of people who might be listening to this podcast, but you know, it's a really important concept and something that you should be able to do while you're playing. And if you're not, you should really listen to that hand and think about the thought process we went through and how we arrived at sort of like 1300 as the bet size to set up the perfect river.
Yeah.
I just thought that was really, really neat and interesting, and might be helpful for a lot of people who don't think that way.
Yeah, I think eventually it'll become one of those things that the math becomes as automatic as, you know, the math of calculating how many big blinds you have and things like that.
Right.
You know, you'll be able to instantly go, okay, I need to bet this much on the turn so that I can make X-sized river shove or whatever.
Yep.
So, yeah, I thought that was really interesting as well. All right, so let's move on and talk a little bit about what is going on in the world of Tournament Poker Edge.
Great.
Obviously, the biggest news of the week is that we brought on Mark Dipthrong Herm to be a guest pro for the site, which I'm over the top excited about.
I cannot wait to watch his videos. Have you ever watched him play?
I've watched him in various tournaments. In fact, I sweated him and Casey when they were deep in the million, which of course Dipthrong went on to win. I started out sweating Casey. And then when Casey busted, I started sweating Dip and sweated him all the way to the win. So it was really interesting. But I can't wait to see the whole cards because that's what's going to be really interesting.
Yeah.
Not necessarily the whole cards from that tournament, but just watching him and his thought process.
Yeah, I think he's like a genius. Like I think he's one of those people who know something that, you know, a lot of people, like just the rest of the world hasn't figured out yet. Because I was watching that too. And, you know, he was riding 10 big blinds the whole time. And he was open folding, but he never was at danger. Like, I don't know. And he was shoving in the appropriate spots. And, obviously I didn't see his cards a lot, but he seemed to make zero mistakes and he knew how to leverage what he had in the perfect spots. And that's so important late in tournaments. And I just, I'm really interested to see what he does there. So I'm excited about him joining as a guest pro as well. Yeah.
And Casey talks really highly of him.
Yeah.
If a big dog thinks somebody's good, then you can pretty much guess they're pretty darn good. So.
Yeah. So that's pretty cool. Excited about that.
Yep. So, stay tuned. We'll be getting some videos out from Dipthrong here real soon.
Yep.
Let's talk a little bit about the Tournament Poker Edge League.
Yeah. So, the league is going strong. We are, how far are we into it now? We're about,
I think as of this recording, we're six tournaments in.
Six tournaments in out of a 2020 tournament season. If you are a member and haven't joined yet, there are 20 tournaments in the cycle. We're going to count the best 10 results. So, by the time you hear this, there'll still be 10 left. So you can still join. I mean, there's no charge to be in it. So it's, there's no... It's just neutral EV to join it anyway, but it actually is plus EV because there's prizes added. And our current leader is Captain Spaulding. He has 83 points. And second place is Potty Train Me with 64 and Rivermen 123 with 63. So it's pretty close. Any one tournament right now, a win and a non-place by one of the top three could change the tournament, the standing significantly, or if you final, top three, some of the last ones, you can, have a good chance of winning it. So it looks like that's moving along well.
Yeah. And I've played in a couple of them and they've been a lot of fun. If for no other reason than just a chance to hang out in the chat room and BS with some of the members. And, it's always fun. So, and they're cheap enough that it's cheaper than going to Starbucks. So it's money well spent, in my opinion. In other areas of the site, we're kind of in full satellite mode in the poker world and on Tournament Poker Edge. Obviously, with FTOPS kicking off soon and the PCA sats running and things like that, a lot of satellite action going on. So we've rolled out some educational materials, if you will, on satellites, including the great article from Cougars 4444 on FTOP satellites.
Yeah.
And also we have some videos, right?
He did it
on satellites.
Yep. He did a series on the FTOP satellite videos, this FTOP satellites, and in his, it's not just basically him loading up and saying, this is what you do. He talks about the type of satellites to play, and this is, very closely tied into his article, which is free. So you don't need to be a member to read the article. You can go check that out. And he talks about, game selection, the best satellites to play, and then how to play them in his video. So that's pretty neat. And also coming up, this is by member demand. This is a pretty neat one that's coming up. Big Dog turned the recorder on a Sunday. So that should be a fun one to watch because he is dominating Sundays this year. So we should have some fun watching how he plays the Sunday majors. And Derek is in the line of fire with his Stick It to the Man series is coming.
I'm so afraid.
Yes, you should be. You should be. I can't wait to see them beat you up.
I think we need to bring in another man.
Yes.
so that we're not the ones who are always getting destroyed. Maybe they can hire we just need an intern or something.
Yeah, right. Well, you know what? I just tell everyone that I started this site for free coaching, and that generally
exactly.
And so anyway, that's coming up too, and that's a good series as well. And that one's Big Dog and T-Twist doing the Stick It to the Man on Derek's play in the, what is it, 10 rebuy? Is that what it was?
Was a 10 rebuy on Full Tilt, so that'll be fun.
Great.
Cool. And one of the things that got a really good reaction that went up recently was your article on bankroll management.
Yeah, you know, I think we've been getting that question every 3 or 4 days, a thread would pop up. What bankroll should I have to play this tournament? What tournament should I be playing with, you know, $2,000 or what bankroll? And I thought it was just time that we sort of formalize the answers that we've been giving in the forum and really think about it deeply and provide some suggestions. So that article is up there. It's an article on bankroll management and game selection. And I give, you know, just some general theory around it and some suggestions based on different bankroll sizes and your level of risk tolerance and, you know, your willingness to go broke. If you're willing to go broke, if you have no fear, then go play, you know, the 1K with the clients.
Like exactly.
Brian was talking about, but in more proper bankroll management, I give you some suggestions on how to play based on your, you know, adversity to risk. So,
yeah, I thought it was a great article and definitely recommend all our listeners to go check that out. And again, that's one of those things that you don't necessarily have to be a member to look at. So go over to tournamentpokeredge.com and check that out. Well worth the time it takes to read that article. So cool. Well, another successful podcast in the books. I thought it was a great episode. Thanks once again to Charles and Ryan for stopping in, and we'll be back in a couple weeks with another episode. Thanks for joining us here on the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. Catch you next time, guys.
Catch you next time. Later, guys.
Hit me, raise it, baby, stay with me. Luck and intuition, play the cards with base to start. And after she's been hooked, I'll play the one that's on her heart. Oh, whoa, whoa, oh, whoa, whoa. I'll get her heart, show her what I've got. Oh, whoa, whoa, oh, whoa, whoa. I'll get her heart, show her what I've got. Gambling is fun when you're with me.
I love it.
Russian roulette is not the same without a gun. And baby, when it's loving, it's not rough, it isn't fun.